Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm sorry for the late start, but as we're likely to discover this afternoon, time is relative in I'm Tim Henry, I'm a producer here at the Rubin Museum of Art, and this is the second of a series of programs we're doing in a series called Brainwave, now in its third year. And this year is quite special because in previous years we've paired all sorts of different people with the neuroscientists to figure out what's going on in our brains. But wrapping our brains around the infinite is infinitely difficult. And so therefore we thought, particularly in celebration of this exciting exhibition, Visions of the Cosmos, we would invite people from different disciplines to sit down with astrophysicists and astronomers to kind of wrap our minds around the universe. And today we have the joint curators of the Visions of the Cosmos exhibition, Martin Brauen, our chief curator here at the Rubin Museum of Art, and Steven Soter from the American Museum of Natural History, to talk about the questions that are raised by this exhibition. So we're delighted that they could come together on stage and do this for us. So I'm going to keep my introduction particularly brief and say welcome, gentlemen, and let's go time traveling. Thank you.
Hi, Steve. Hello. Welcome, everybody. When I was a child, and later on when I was a teenager, I was interested in exploring design. I built myself a telescope, a tripod, and I have explored the universe. Obviously, I didn't become an astrophysicist as you. I first studied medicine and later on Buddhism and then anthropology. And now I've done this exhibition. What about you? How did you come to be interested in astrophysics and in the exploring the cosmos?
For me, it began in the second grade when I learned that there was a solar system in other worlds and we had these wonderful concentric orbits around the sun. And occurred to me then for the first time that there was more to existence than sort of Los Angeles where I grew up. Very exciting idea. And then later, as I was entering college, it was at that time that the space program really took off and I realized it would be possible to study this, to actually become an astronomer. And so we did. When we talk about the cosmos today, I would like to talk about several subjects or chapters. One would be how did all this happen? I mean, how did the cosmos start to exist and how is it developing? Another question would be, which is always interesting for people, what's the relationship between the human beings and the cosmos? And maybe the third part, if you still have time before then we open to the public, would be how adequate is what the scientists say today. Is it really true? Because is it reality? But first let's talk about how did all this start. But I would not like to start in the present time. Then maybe we can go back and see, observe, or somehow previous people, people in previous times saw the cosmos. But based on the present knowledge, how did the cosmos start to exist?
The present knowledge is based on an observation that the distant galaxies appear to be moving away from us in all directions. And it was then realized that it's not because we're at the center that they're fleeing from us. This is what you would observe if space is uniformly expanding everywhere, that every galaxy would see the same thing. And that's an observation. If the galaxies are moving away from each other, then if you run the movie backwards in time, in your mind, in the past they were closer together, and if you continue running back in time, there would be a time when they were all in the same place, or if there was infinite density in matter, and that came to be called the Big Bang, and you can calculate from the observed rate of expansion of the galaxies how long ago that was. It works out to about 13.7 billion years. That's an extraordinary, almost preposterous idea that everything in the observable universe, not the most distant galaxies, was all in the same place at some point in time. But but it seems to be consistent with all the things that we've observed. There were predictions that were made on the basis of the Big Bang theory that we would observe a faint glow in microwave light at a particular temperature in all directions. That was observed. The prediction was made about 1948, the discovery was made in 1965. And there were other predictions that were made on the basis of the theory, too. So, as preposterous as it seems, it appears to meet every observational test. So we accept it provisionally as a view of how the universe began.
We have some small technical problems because I would want to show the picture of these, how the universe looks. I think about 50,000 years after the Big Bang. Now, I don't know how to transfer this picture from my computer or the technician can solve the problem in the meantime. But still, I don't know, Simon. You say that we have a feeling, we on Earth, that the universe is expanding from our point. And other, I mean, people, if there would be people on some, in some completely different place in the universe, would have the same feeling. How can this be? I mean, there's only one point of origin.
All the things in the observable universe that you can see could have been infinite density at one point. Then you have very rapid expansion. So now the observable energy of this universe is equivalent to about 13.7 billion light years away. Now, everyone else in the universe is doing the same thing. There's one center in this universe, and there's no edge.
Is there no center in light because it's infinite?
It could be.
But we don't know.
We don't know. Because the conditions of observation impose a horizon beyond which we cannot see. The further back we look in space, the further back we're looking in time, because light travels at a finite speed across space. So the farther the path that we had to travel, the longer it took. And if it began 13.7 billion years ago, then you cannot see light that began further in time than that. So you cannot see up into space, further in space than the equivalent of light travel time. Now, that doesn't mean that there's not more universe extending beyond it, and perhaps infinitely. If you wait a billion years and look at the universe again, you'll be able to see out to 14.7 billion light years in all directions. But that horizon is an artifact of the conditions of observation. The universe has a finite age and there's a finite speed of light. It's exactly analogous to the horizon at sea. If you're on a ship in the open ocean, it seems that there is an edge all around you at the same distance in all directions. But if you then travel to that edge, you'll see the same thing again. You're now at the center of a new horizon. But that horizon doesn't have a physical reality. It's imposed by the conditions of observation, in that case, a spherical Earth. In the case of the cosmos, the conditions that limit our ability to see beyond the horizon are the finite age of the universe and the finite speed of light. So we cannot see what's beyond that horizon.
But it still seems to be more complicated because I recently read, but maybe that's already considered, that actually maybe it's not a ball, the universe, but it's rather maybe something like this. What about this?
I don't think there's any definite observations that there's a curvature to space on a large scale. There were early models coming from the time after Einstein that the universe would be curved. The simplest thing seems to be the case that there's no overall curvature to space. But there's local orbital space with the concentrations of matter.
Well, let's go back to the Big Bang.
Yeah.
I mean, is it true that this was mostly a tiny, small, not measurable point, and out of this, everything evolved?
Nobody knows exactly the conditions at the earliest instant, because it's outside the range of both physical theory and observational experiment. But in the first few seconds after that, from that point on, physicists can track what happened, how fast it expanded, how energy was converted into particles of matter, how those particles fused to make expansion. The universe had cooled sufficiently that fusion came to a stop. And we were left with hydrogen and helium, the two gases.
Okay.
And then nothing else happened after that until, locally, clumps of these gases condensed, collapsed under gravity to make stars, and compressed and heated their interiors and recreated, in some sense, the conditions of the first few minutes of the universe as a whole, high temperatures and pressure. And then fusion continued. And that's what's happening in the Sun and the other stars. And that's where the heavier elements all came from. The elements heavier than hydrogen and helium, the carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, in our bodies, the silicon, iron, calcium in our planet, all of those things were fused in the hearts of stars long ago. And then those stars died, and either explosively, spewing that material into space, or gradually leaking off from their atmosphere to mix into the interstellar medium of gas and dust, out of which form new generations of stars. So this is what happens in the galaxy.
How do you, I would say in an American way, how do you guys know that? In a few seconds or minutes. How can
we don't know for certain. This is an extrapolation from what we do observe, from the expansion of the universe that we do observe, running the movie back in time, and then applying the laws of physics to those conditions.
Mm-hmm.
And we can do that, we think, all the way back to the first few seconds after the Big Bang, but not much earlier, because the theory cannot cope with these infinite densities and the state of matter that it's not possible in this present state of our knowledge.
Would it be that there were a second, a third, and maybe a fifth Big Bang?
Yes. And there's even speculation along the following intriguing lines. The conditions of the Big Bang were extreme density and pressure and temperature. Those are the same conditions that obtain when you have a supermassive star that explodes in a supernova and the remnant of it collapses to make a black hole.
Okay.
At the center of that black hole is something called a singularity, which has this incredible density and pressure and temperature. It's like the conditions of the Big Bang itself. So the speculation is, if there's the same conditions that occurred in the formation of a black hole, as was the case in the Big Bang, maybe there's another Big Bang. Maybe the universe is being born out of the remnant of a collapsed star in a black hole. So every place where we have a black hole in our universe, the speculation goes, there could be a new universe that's given birth there, is expanding there like our own, but we can't observe it because it's inside the black hole.
Mm.
But this is just a speculation. It's an intriguing one. It's consistent with what we know, but it's very hard to get observational evidence.
This is, by the way, the picture you were referring to.
Yes.
This
is an all-sky image of what's called the cosmic microwave background radiation.
Mm-hmm.
And we observe this in every direction in the sky using microwave antennas.
Okay.
And it's false color coding. These are not real colors. But what it represents is differences in local temperature and density at this point in time. So the red ones are denser regions, and the blue ones are less dense regions. And this is the whole sky projected on this image. Now this was the in some sense like a baby picture of the universe, or the face of the Big Bang. It's the remnant glow of that bright flash, the explosion of the universe.
So virtually how it looked 350,000 years after the Big Bang.
This is how the universe looked about 350,000 years after the Big Bang. And we cannot see back to the Big Bang itself because in that earlier period the universe was opaque. Light would not travel through it because there were too many electrons freely floating around and scattering the light. After 350,000 years of expansion and cooling, the electrons were captured by the nuclei, by the protons became neutral hydrogen atoms, and the universe became then transparent. Light traveled across it and carried images, and this is the image that we see.
Mm-hmm.
And the extraordinary thing about it is it's not uniform, it's clumpy. And these clumps are thought to be the seeds of what will later evolve to become clusters and superclusters of galaxies. So this is a representative sample of it. So to come back to the origin, only helium and hydrogen to like element number one and two, there was only time for fusion to give rise to helium, a little bit of lithium, element number three, but not much. And then lithium, helium, element number three. Hydrogen, helium, lithium. You can't do too much with that. You can't make planets for life. But that came later. Because this expanding gas of hydrogen, helium, a little bit of lithium. Locally, you see these clumps here. This picture is before the red stars. Slight clumpiness of matter. Those local concentrations collapse under their own gravity. So in the opposite direction of the general expansion of space, locally there was condensation, increased in density. That formed galaxies, and within the galaxies, stars. And in the hearts of those stars, it recreated the very high temperature and high density conditions in the first few minutes after the Big Bang, and fusion was then able to resume. Fusing the hydrogen and the helium into the heavier elements. And those are the ones that we need later to go into making planets and dust.
I would like to show you a picture if it works, otherwise, you go on to the exhibition of some sort of Big Bang, but in the Hindu side. I call it the Big Bang, but it's of course not the same period. It shows Vishnu lying on a circle, which is called Ananta, and that means indefinite. And he's sleeping there, you know. And now the Big Bang consists in the moment when the partner of Vishnu is massaging his feet, you know. Suddenly, light is coming into Vishnu, and out of his navel, the lotus flower is growing, and on the lotus flower, Brahma, and out of Brahma, the entire universe. I think it's something similar, because we don't know if the Big Bang was short or long, but it was somehow initiated by, you don't see it here, not there. Anyway, you go up to the exhibition. The interesting thing is not so much the story, but the interesting thing, I think, is the notion of time. And that's something which is very similar to our present knowledge, because the Hindus believe in the time of so-called kalpas, eons, which are extremely large. And we are showing in the Buddhist section, or we are quoting in the Buddhist section, the story which shows this time notion. Imagine a square, which is, or a cube, which has 50 kilometers on each side, so a very large square. It's about 10 miles, 10 miles, 10 miles. And this square, this cube, is filled with tips of hairs. And every 100 years, you take out one of these hairs. And when the entire cube is empty, only one solar day is over. 32,000 solar days are small ion, and the multiple of it is a medium ion, and then a large ion. So it's something that you can't express in words. And I feel so fascinated that nowadays we have a very similar notion of time and space.
Hindu cosmology seems to be the only one of the traditional and ancient ones that gives the same order of time scale as modern astrophysics. There's billions of years for the universe.
Exactly. Yeah. And I think that's so fascinating.
Yeah. But of course, they came out of it from a highly different way.
Maybe let's go back to our own cosmology. It looks quite different 600 years ago. Maybe you can explain us a little bit why it was like that. Because I read also that early Greeks, I think even in the before Christ, had a quite different worldview.
What we see is that the appearance of the planets and the stars moving around us. So it looks like the Earth is stationary at the center, and then it's going in cycles around us. And those were the traditional Western cosmologies, coming from Mesopotamia and then later by the Greeks. There was one breakaway from this, and it's simply those Aristarchus of Samos, I think in the 3rd century BC, mm-hmm. or 4th century BC, who actually imagined that the Earth was a planet and the sun was a center. But there was no evidence for it, and it was dismissed, basically. It wasn't revised until 1453 when Copernicus published his book on the solar system, putting the sun in the center. Copernicus did not realize the full implications of that. He never stated that. It was just a change in the geometry, a new center, not the Earth, but the sun. So the Earth was going around with the other planets. The full implications of that only came later, the realization that the suns were other stars, that they had planets like our own sun, and that if the Earth is a planet, then the planets are other Earths. In some sense, they're worlds. The previous view had been that the heavens in the west were something completely different from the Earth. The Earth was the realm of corruption and decay and change, and the heavens were perfect and immutable. This view was then challenged after Copernicus, and people realized that those things are not just lights in the sky, perfect coexistences, but they were worlds, maybe the same stuff as the Earth. It was confirmed first by Galileo, first use of a telescope to look at the picture as well. Okay, that's the place. There's the sun in the center. But he has the sphere of the stars out here. It now doesn't have to circle around the Earth because it's the Earth that's going around the sun, but it still has all the stars at the same distance in this outermost sphere, and these are the spheres of the other planets. There's the Earth with the moon going around.
We also have another system, I think it's this one, which is quite...
This was the first big step toward the modern view. This is 1576. Thomas James published this in England. This was the introduction of the Copernican system to the English-speaking world. And he has, again, the sun at the center, the Earth with the moon going around it. But the one thing he does now is that the stars are not on the surface of this outer sphere, they're extending out into space. And he even says, infinitely extending themselves. He doesn't identify them as suns, but he allows them to be going out into infinite space. Mm-hmm. And a few years after this, Giordano Bruno, an Italian monk, drew the full conclusions and made the Copernican idea truly revolutionary. He said that the universe is infinite, that the stars are suns, that like our own sun, they have planets, and that those planets are inhabited. Mm-hmm. But it was a brilliant guess. It was not based on scientific reasoning or observation. It could well have been wrong. It turned out to be right. As far as we know, not all. We don't know that there's life on the other planets yet, but
maybe we can still talk about it.
Yes.
But I would like to come back once more to the Asian notion, because I have explained how the Hindus see the time, the cosmic time. But if you go back to the Buddhist notion, it's also interesting because you find something which is again very similar to, if you look at the tonka like this, which is also in the exhibition, this is actually a world system, and I really put emphasis on one world system. And if you translate the text actually into a model based on the measurements mentioned in the text, you find this, or you can create this structure. It's a large cylinder, water, and there is gold or earth. And this diameter, just that you have an idea of this space, is about 2.7 million kilometers. So it's very large. And we human beings are living here. But now that's not so interesting. But the fact that in Buddhist texts it said that actually subsystems, there's not only one system, but 1 million subsystems. And they would be arranged in a way like that, on a very large base, which is nearly infinite. It has a certain thickness, interestingly, but it is nearly infinite, the diameter is nearly infinite. And we are, as I said, 1,000 multiplied by 1,000 multiplied by 1,000. In other words, a nearly infinite number of such world systems standing there. And I think it's really incredible if you compare this with this very narrow worldview of medieval times in Europe.
it's compatible with, again, as Hindu cosmology had a time scale of billions of years, if this has a distance scale of looking at billions of light years, possibly, then it's of the same order as modern cosmology. What we should see within the cosmic horizon, the observable universe, contains something on the order of 100 billion galaxies. And those galaxies each contain 100 billion galaxies. And we can take a census of sample volumes of the observable universe, and we've done that with the Hubble telescope. And each galaxy has something of the order of 100 billion stars. So you multiply those two numbers together, 10 to the 22 stars. And that's only within the observable universe, the part to which we're limited in our observations. The whole thing could be infinite.
I think you came to this conclusion when you were doing this picture here. I think it's a very fascinating this one, isn't it?
This is the so-called Hubble Deep Field. The Hubble explained to us how small this part of the sky is. It's a very tiny part of the sky that the dimensions. It's much smaller than the size of the moon. And so I've been a part of the sky where nothing much extraordinary is happening. But it was a super long exposure. The Hubble telescope dwelt on this spot for about 11 days to collect the light from very faint and distant galaxies. And you're seeing the faintest objects in that picture are extending back almost to something like 12 billion light years distant. Every image in that picture, I believe, is a galaxy. There may be a star or two in our own galaxy that's right in our face, up close, like that one is a star. That one is a star. Anything with the spikes, let's speak of the rest of our galaxies. The rest are galaxies, and the bright ones are very relatively close, and the faint ones are very far near to the horizon. That's exactly something like, I believe, 10,000 galaxies in that image. So when you take a sample picture like that in one part of the sky, they did it again in another part of the sky, they seem relatively the same thing. It seems to be uniform distribution and density of galaxies extending out into space. So that we can do a census, and that's where you get that number, something like 100 billion galaxies. And also in this picture, the further and the most distant ones that you see are younger. We're seeing them back in time. Mm-hmm. And so you see cosmic evolution occurring here. And that's another important thing for modern astrophysics. It's not just the universe is static, it's evolving. Its state today is different than it was soon after the Big Bang.
This fact actually was the reason why we have the subtype of the evolving universe. You actually told us to use this subtype of the evolving universe. Now, that's the evolving universe, but what will happen? What is the fate of the universe based on what you know?
The thought that the universe expanded after the Big Bang would gradually slow down in its expansion because of its own gravity pulling back on everything attracting everything else, that would eventually reach a maximum state of expansion and then collapse on itself and come back into something called the Big Crunch. That had been a view until 1998, or thereabouts, I believe, when the evidence of observations of distant galaxies seems to show now that the expansion of the universe is accelerating. It's doing the opposite of what was expected. There seems to be another force that's working to oppose gravity, and it's stronger, and it is causing the expansion of the universe to accelerate. And if that continues, then the expansion of the universe will go on without end.
How would you explain that it accelerates? Is there another force which attracts?
There seems to be another force, which it's just given the name of dark energy, but that's just the name. We don't know what it is. It seems to be the property of space itself. That's a repelling force, opposite of gravity. And the more space there is with the expansion of space, the more that force comes into play. We don't know what it is. In fact, we're extraordinarily ignorant about a lot of very important things. Not only don't we know what that energy is, we don't even know what a lot of the matter. I mean, okay, here, I'll back up for a moment.
observe luminous objects and things that interact with light, we can infer that there's a lot more matter that is exerting gravity. We can see its effects on galaxies and on stars within galaxies, but we cannot identify its source. We cannot see where it's coming from. This is called dark matter. It was first discovered in the 1930s in clusters of galaxies, and later by another Rubin in our own galaxy and in other galaxies. It looks like the dark matter accounts for something like 5 to 10 times more of the gravity in the universe than the matter that we can see. And we don't know
where the light came off the wrong. The light came off.
It's not generating light, it's not reflecting light, it's not absorbing light, it's not interacting with light, it's a different kind of matter. All that it does, we are familiar with, is it exerts gravity. It is causing deflections of the movement of the objects that we can see, of stars and of whole galaxies.
That's the way how we know it.
That's how we know it's there. We're inferring its existence because we can see through its footprints. We don't see the thing itself, it's invisible. We don't know what it is. And as
we know how far it is,
it's within our own galaxy. It may even be within our neighborhood, to some extent, within the galaxy, in our Milky Way. And within our Milky Way, yeah. We're definitely within our Milky Way. So this is something like 5 to 10 times the matter, and some kind of matter, if you define matter as something that exerts gravity, it's a different kind of matter. This is almost an embarrassment. 5 to 10 times, and then on top of that, you've got this so-called dark energy, which is causing an anti-gravity acceleration in the expansion of the universe. We don't know what that is either. So most of the stuff that we have evidence in the universe, we are clueless as to what it is. And so this is a the larger the extent of what we know, the larger the boundary with the unknown.
Actually, no wonder. I mean, we were born as hunters, and not really, our thing is not to find out what's going on in the universe. I mean, we don't have the capacity to do it.
Actually, it's an extraordinary thing that we've been able to learn as much as we can. As here we have these little creatures, you know, just 6 feet tall, one is floating dust, on one particular planet around one star in this galaxy, we've been able to find out that there are other galaxies, that the universe is expanding, and there's billions of years old. And to be able to actually base that on observations and measurement and reasoning, it's an extraordinary thing.
Mm-hmm. Let's go a little bit to the second part, the relationship between human beings and the cosmos. There are the theories that they are very close relationship, and those who do not believe in astrology say, what do you do as a scientist say?
Well, astrology began from the observation that it looked like everything, all the planets were going around us. These lights in the sky were, in some sense, a pageant directed with us as the audience in mind, and it must be about us. And later when we learned that we're not the center, that we're one of those things moving with them around the sun, and the sun is only one of 100 billion stars in our own Milky Way galaxy, the scientific view is that it's not about us. And so the basis of astrology, which began as a Babylonian religion, actually, is incompatible with what we now know. So that's my take on astrology.
But there seems to be a very close relationship between us and the universe.
Yes.
I bet they all have. You know, they were calling, wrote to me a very interesting email and told me, because he told me this once in the talk, and I couldn't believe it. And then I told him, did I understand you correctly? And he said, about the teaspoons worth of atoms in my body, in your body, in anybody's body, have not reprocessed into other types of atoms since the universe began.
Yeah.
In other words, somewhere in me, if I would collect it, there would be a teaspoon of atoms which go back really far.
Yeah.
Is this true?
Yeah, more than that.
How do you measure this?
We know that all the heavier elements were made, but the more extraordinary fact is that is star stuff. It was fused and forged in the hearts of stars. So there is a deep connection of us to the cosmos. It's not that we are the centerpiece of this world, but we are intimately connected to it. It's the cosmos is in us, literally. The stuff we're made of was forged in the hearts of stars.
But that's great. That's exactly what, again, the Hindus and the Buddhists say. I mean, the cosmos is within us. I would like to show you some of these wonderful representations or pictures we have in the exhibition. When you see a human being as a cosmos man representing both, you know, the microcosm and the macrocosm. And in which, of course, something Steven would agree, it's on that science. Attributed to certain parts or joints of the human being. But the notion, the idea, I think, is really fascinating. If I hear the news theory, what you tell me, that actually we are a part of the Big Bang or the stars which evolved out of the Big Bang.
We're children of the stars.
Or, for instance, this representation of the Loka Purusha, the Jain representation, where you see here the heavens, here the world, the human beings, and here the heavens, also representing in one way or the other a similar notion that we are all part of this cosmic system.
So the idea was intuitive long ago in antiquity, and I think in some sense it's been verified by it. This rigorous discoveries of astrophysics that we come from the stars. Your preoccupation with this with the cosmology, with the universe, did it change something in yourself that is related to your belief? Because I go back to the movie you made, and we will show in the end this movie, which we made together with the American Museum of Natural History. We are flying to the cosmos and then back, and this movie was shown, or is still shown, on YouTube. And it's extremely successful. More than 3.5 million people have looked at it. And if you look at the commentaries, it's very interesting. These commentaries are really extraordinary. I mean, some people say, I realize how tiny I am. I have some quotes here. Sorry when I quote this just, but it's so clear and obvious. And I still can't comprehend how fucking huge it is. Or nothing is too probably the most truthful statement I made. Or some people have already been right about their belief in God, that they realize that now really there must be some divine being who has created all this. How did this preoccupation, this occupation with cosmology change your belief, if at all? I don't think it changed. But one thing that it emphasized for me is a kind of humility, first of all, of what we don't know, and second, realizing the magnitude and the age of the universe and the relative insignificance of our individual passions. In that, to me, if you internalize that, it is like an inoculation against any form of fanaticism. It's incompatible with that. It should inculcate a kind of humility. And I think that's a good thing. I'm going to leave that.
Mm-hmm. Maybe you can come back to the national to offer all these girls like you once more. Sorry. But before we started our discussion, I told you, if I would be quite honest here, if I would be, say, a congressman in the United States and had to and responsible, I don't know if it's Congress or somebody else, anyway, the person comment, and you should convince me why you want to invest billions of dollars into exploring space. What would you argue? How would you argue?
Well, the amount of things that spends on these observations we're talking about. Not talking about astronauts in space, that's much more expensive.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think that can be defended. But the amount we're spending for the Hubble telescope and its comparable instruments and the work that's going to analyze this information, I think mostly the public is willing to support that because they're interested.
in the questions that it's answering, and it has to do with our origins, where we came from, our place in the universe, understanding that better. So there's always been this popular level of support for astronomy. I don't think, and the it sounds like a lot, $1 billion for a spacecraft, and as the same sum of money it is, but distributed over the population, it's a relatively small amount. It's much less than we spend on cosmetics or entertainment or other things like that. I think people are generally willing to support that. They feel that they're getting the money's worth.
You still couldn't convince me that would be a problem. I mean, to be curious about it is one thing, but does it help anything? And when, so what and why, or is it like the wrong?
I think it helps in a sense that to the extent that we understand and are grounded in some sense of reality, it makes us better people.
Maybe we are exploring the universe because of something we still don't know. That could be.
Yes.
Is it force in us to go to our roots, maybe?
Yes.
To explore our roots.
There's that one slide of the I remember which one. It's a little further down. What is beyond the horizon? Something that is always fascinated people. This looks like a medieval wood fence, actually not from the 1880s, but it's in the style of that, but it represents the idea. Here was the firmament, the stars, and a seeker always wants to know what is beyond that horizon. I think that's part of being human and part of what astronomy is providing is the satisfaction of at least addressing this kind of desire in us.
Should we ask the audience or the
Because otherwise, the general thinkers here. So, what we'll do, we've got microphones on that side of the house, so if you raise your hand and I'll see how in secret how we do this. There's a first part, so I'll manage to get back to this gentleman, and the second one, which I also know that there. Okay. Thank you.
This was a very interesting lecture, by the way. What is parallel universe? And the next program is teaching now by, I think, Professor Piku from Mason Museum of Natural History about parallel universe, because it really wasn't giving out. And another dimension, like a dinosaur can walk through the whole place because it's in another dimension. I'm a little confused. Maybe it's a fairy tale. But there are books written on top of the universe right now, as we speak, by eminent astrophysicist astronomers.
Well, I think it's purely speculation at this point. I'm not familiar with the particular person that you mentioned.
Nico or Kiko or something? The Japanese gentleman?
No, I don't know. Okaku.
Okaku.
Ryuji Okaku?
Yes, that was close.
Yeah, I'm not sure what this is referring to, but
probably the multiverse.
Okay. There's an idea that our Big Bang is just one of an infinite number of universes that are coming into being. That cannot be verified or dismissed on the basis of observations. So it's the realm of speculation at this point. People also sometimes talk about parallel universes in the sense that there can be other dimensions that are intersecting our own, but that we don't have direct access to them. But in this space, in this very room, there's another universe present. Because again, it's just pure speculation. As long as we kept doing observations to test these ideas, there's not much that one can do in them, except it's just entertaining to think about.
Jerry, your comment that you made towards the end, as you know, about 50 years ago, Robert Wilson kind of wondered from his mind to a question from the Congressman about why would we accelerate or what it would do for the defense of the country. That was just saying, nothing for the defense of the country, but it will help make the country worth defending.
Yes.
it should be called string hypothesis, and there's a difference.
Yeah.
In science, you imagine an idea to explain some set of observations, that's called a hypothesis, and that hypothesis usually then has some testable predictions that it makes, and you go out and observe or do experiments to see if it meets the test, and if it doesn't, then it's wrong. You try another hypothesis. Okay. If it survives the test, then it continues to survive all tests, and it continues to withstand the most critical scrutiny, then eventually it's accepted as a theory. And so we have the theory of gravitation, we have the atomic theory of matter, we have the germ theory of infectious disease, and so on. This is the gold standard of science. It doesn't mean that they're absolutely true or proven. They could be, some of them could be disproven tomorrow, but it's what we accept today because it worked to in every way that we can imagine applying it. So string theory is a misnomer because it has not been tested at all. There's no experiments. And even now, many decades, it's still at the realm of just being an idea and a hypothesis. And there's been an awful lot of effort devoted to it, and it's probably producing a lot of very beautiful mathematics, but whether it has anything to do with the real universe or not is a completely open question. That's my take on it, but I'm not here right with this.
Any more questions from people? Okay, we have this gentleman over here.
When people talk about the state at the beginning of the, before the Big Bang, where this point of infinite density, to me, the question ever since I was a child is, where is that? What is the context of that?
Yeah.
And I was wondering if there are theories about what that's all about, because of course we're talking about things that are way beyond our ability to even conceive of that, of a pure nothingness or whatever it is, but are there theories about that?
Well, it wasn't a point within our universe. It wasn't in that direction or in that direction. Everything in the general universe was within that point, and then the entire thing exploded and expanded. It doesn't have a center or an edge. I don't think I can satisfy you on this question.
Another question is, when you were showing the slide of the Hubble telescope shot, and the galaxies that are in the foreground, the stars in the near foreground, the galaxies, and then beyond that. If, from what I understand about the Big Bang, why would there be some things that are further out than others? In other words, if everything started out in this infinitely dense point, why do some things get a head start and other things don't?
Because space itself is expanding. And so if you take
Mike explained that.
Go down a little bit.
This one?
Take that one. Yeah, that one.
Okay. Wherever you have to learn this, you're okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so here's a bunch of galaxies in the expanding universe.
And we're on that one, say,
so we're the observer.
And the other ones appear to be moving away from us, and the farther away they are, the faster they're moving away from us. Now, any other observer would see exactly the same thing. Any two places are moving apart with a velocity which is proportional to their separation, the distance between them. That's a uniform expansion of space. So that's why some parts have gotten much farther away from us than others. And it's not that we're in the center and everything is moving away from us. That's what it appears to be for every one of these galaxies. If you were sitting on that one, you would see exactly the same thing. Now, this is what we think is actually happening now. All of these galaxies, this is the same moment in time. But this is what we're forced to observe by the fact that light travels at a finite speed and the universe is a finite age. So again, here we are as an observer, and the galaxies near us are of the same age, they're evolved, they're large. We look out further and further in space, we're looking further back in time, we're looking to galaxies that were younger and smaller and also more crowded, because back in time, the universe was smaller, so they're closer together. Finally, at the very observable edge, we had this cosmic microwave background horizon. That's the dashed line. That corresponds to the color-coded picture I showed you of the globe, the remnant globe of the Big Bang, And that hides the actual cosmic horizon, which is beyond that. We can't see that. So this is what we observe. It's a schematic, but it's what we observe. It's more complicated than the previous picture I showed you of what there is at this moment in time, that all galaxies are the same age or equally evolved. And there's no edge in that picture. The real situation, there's no edge and there's no center. Here there appears to be a center and there appears to be an edge. But this is an artifact, again. This is the cosmic horizon. It's imposed by the finite speed of light and the finite age of the universe.
Okay. All right. So we have one question over here for the microphone, and who's next?
Hi.
Sorry. Just let's find out who is next. Who had their hands up over here? There were a cluster, star cluster. All right. So you and the beard will be next on that side. Then let's get that mic to this gentleman over here, and then we'll come to you. Thank you.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a question. Everything that we know about the universe is governed by the laws of physics, and those laws seem to change on a super micro level. And is it possible that the fundamental laws of the universe change when you're dealing with the super macro?
Yes. It could be that the laws change on a scale which is larger than that which we can observe. But so far we haven't found that. We haven't found evidence.
A question for you. I'm thinking of this expanding universe and I'm thinking of our nation's deficit. If you had a to-do list of what really needed to happen in terms of the future of this so-called space program, what would you prioritize if we needed to send them to Washington?
Well, I would prioritize the unmanned spacecraft exploring the solar system and the space telescopes and the ground-based telescopes, and I would put absolutely at the lowest priority manned spacecraft or astronautics. I don't think that has delivered, since the lunar landings, that has not delivered anything to us. I think it's been an enormous expense and no science has come out of it.
Hi. You've been very careful to explain what you know, what you don't know, and how you know what you know. And I know that scientists are forced to take the things that are derived from mathematics and observation and put it into plain language. And it seems to me that lay people have a lot of trouble absorbing these ideas, and especially issues around scale in both space and time and in probability issues. So what suggestions would you have for the educational system to help scientific literacy those issues?
Well, one thing, for example, talking about scale, space, how to get your head around that, how to understand it. One thing that I find useful is to make analogies to the following kind. Within our experience of time, we're familiar with what a second is, and we're familiar with what a year is, and we know something about the ratio of those two from our own experience. But you can apply that to distance scales in the universe. Using the speed of light as your yardstick, the moon is about one light second away. It takes about a second for the light to get from the moon to us. And the sun is about 8 minutes of light travel time away. Okay, so it's as farther from the moon in the same ratio as 8 minutes is to 1 second. And the nearest stars are a few light years away. Okay, so you can begin to have a feel, an internal feeling for what these ratios are, because it's scaling into something that we do understand. So that's one piece of advice.
But do you think that there's a general problem with the educational system in people's ability to absorb this information?
I think if you introduce things like that and powers of 10, not thinking in terms of arithmetical linear measurement, but in logarithmic measurement, for example. We do this when we talk about earthquake magnitudes, for example. Each magnitude unit of one is a order of magnitude more energy than the previous one. So you can apply, and you apply that to distances and times and any other measures. So teach orders of magnitude thinking. And once people understand that, then it's easy to get your head around these numbers. It's hopeless to try to imagine 6 trillion miles. That's a light year. But you can think of it as a year, and how far light travels in a year. When at that same speed, it's going around the circumference of the Earth 7 times in 1 second. You can then begin to do these ratios in your head. So these astronomical numbers are not incomprehensible. There are these tools to make them comprehensible.
I think the main question NASA is exploring is not even the tremendous secret military use. And there's no question. That's the space I'm talking about.
A tremendous military.
There must be some applications to military. That might be sad. But my question is, green paradox. Can you explain green paradox? That one green is covering the city of light, the other one is on the park.
Okay. Well, first, to answer the first part, I don't see any military applications to space. Now, twin paradox. What this is about is time dilation, Einsteinian relativity, that if a pair of twins on the Earth, one stays on the Earth, the other goes into a rocket and travels near the speed of light for a great distance and then comes back, they will be completely different ages. Okay, and so why is it that the one that is on the rocket comes back younger than the one that stayed behind? Cannot you just imagine that it was the one in the rocket that was stationary and the Earth was moving away? So this was the so-called twin paradox. And the resolution of it is that they're not identical. The one actually has to undergo an acceleration to come back, whereas the Earth doesn't. I don't know if that... They're not the symmetrical situation.
We have time for two more questions, so let's get the microphone back there, and then, madam, why don't we get the microphone to you? So you're closer, so we'll get to you first, all right? Here's the microphone coming to you right now.
I was wondering if you could tell us what your work focuses on.
Lately I was involved in this controversy about the status of Pluto as a planet. It's not a planet. It's a type of planet. There's very good reasons for regarding it as such. I've been working planetary astronomy. I'm the farthest end from the cosmology that we've been discussing. I'm interested in things relatively on a small scale of planets in our solar system and other solar systems.
But you were also participating in this very famous TV series with Carl.
Oh, yes, I worked with Carl Sagan and we had to write the Cosmos Television.
Which we are, by the way, screening on Wednesdays at lunchtimes. And the schedule is in the Brainwave brochure, of course. Okay, so if you've got free time for an hour on Wednesday lunchtimes, do join us. So, yes, we have a final question over there.
Thank you for being here. My question is, I was taught Maya Mitchell was the first astronomer to observe color in the stars.
To observe color?
Yes.
The stars Maya Mitchell?
On the photograph that you had earlier, the stars definitely from the Hubble telescope,
yeah.
There was definitely color in the stars?
Yes, there definitely is color.
The second part of my question is whether the Buddhists in their art attributed color to stars in anything that you've seen.
Well, as you can see on the clear night sky that stars are different colors. You can see that Betelgeuse, the shoulder of Orion, is a reddish star, and other stars are bluish. And this is a reflection of their temperatures. The redder stars are relatively cooler stars, and the bluer ones are hotter.
Thank you. And as far as Buddhist art, is there any record?
Not really. No, I mean, if you look at the two texts I know about cosmology, Buddhist cosmology, one is the tradition of the Abhidharma Posha. The cylinder I showed is related to this. There's no indication, no mentioning of colors.
different stars. And if you go also to the color chakra, to the other system, there is no reference to color. It's not completely correct, per se. I mean, a single system in the color chakra tradition has different layers and has different colors. But it is always the same pattern for each system. So in other words, there are different colors of different universal systems.
The color of the stars turns out to be an extraordinarily important thing in astrophysics. Not grossly as we perceive colors, but if you take if you make a rainbow spectrum, if you spread the light from a star apart and analyze it in great detail, you'll see in that fine structure of its colors basically the fingerprints of all the atoms that that star is made of, the different kinds of atoms in their relative proportions and the temperature and pressure. You learn an enormous amount about the stars from their applied analysis of their colors using atomic physics to interpret it. This turned out to be extremely important. It was the birth of modern astrophysics, in fact.
Thank you. If also one of the might say something, and yes, Martin, to consideration of the movement. So I have a little bit of a to answer that paper. And it's not the reason why, I don't know if I have a last word, but maybe it's not the reason. One of my last questions would have been, who is right now? And we don't know. But I think famous Tibetan Rinpoche, famous Tibetan Tunku, said on something which is, I think, quite near to the reality. He was asked which of these universe systems is correct. I mean, he was asked the Tibetan one, the Hindu one, or the one, Western one. And he said, on the relative level, each of these systems has a certain kernel of truth, and on an absolute level, each is wrong.
I'm not saying that anything is right, but I think that it's possible to show that certain things are wrong. That if they're not compatible with observations, they're wrong, at least as an interpretation of physical reality. That the observations have got to be the final arbiter of what is wrong. It doesn't mean that what survives that is necessarily right. You can show that certain things are wrong.
Okay. So yeah, I'm not sure that either of you are right. In the sense that I think imagery that an art museum should have the last word, as it were. And Martin and Steven working together on this extraordinary film that 6 minutes and 13 seconds in length, which has now made its way onto YouTube and gone seriously viral. About 3.5 million hits right now. And it's called The Known Universe. So we're going to run that film as our concluding gesture this afternoon. But before we do, I just wanted Steven Soter is too modest to mention it, but he has a book out called Cosmic Horizons, which is on sale at the shop. And so Steven and Martin will be upstairs at the shop at the end if you want to buy any and have them signed. You'd be very welcome to. And also, if you do want to understand a little more about the Mandalic Buddhist system of cosmology, much of it can be found in Martin's brilliant catalogue to a massive show that has now closed here at the museum, but nonetheless, there is a little stardust left in this catalogue for people to sample. And, after all, as the student suggested, if you say spend it on cosmetics and spend it on cosmos, you might have done it. Okay, so let's run the film, and Steven may well want to provide a commentary as we watch it, but it's a very quick and billion light year experience. Enjoy.
Based on actual observational data, nothing was invented.
Earth's orbit. Accelerating as we're pulling away. A million light years away now. Everything that you see now is a galaxy. The color coding is through gravitational affinity. Those are groups of galaxies that are bound together. And these gaps are where beta is missing parts of the large scale structure that has not yet been mapped. Into its stars, clouds of gas and dust from which new stars are being formed. And our own star. And its resting planets. Lights on the dark side of the earth. That's our civilization. It's Europe up here.
Thank you so much for coming out to Brainwave and Rubin Museum of Art.